great pleasure to be with you today. This is probably the first time I lectured in the, or I say, a session in the Egyptian Tibetan Association. And I'm sure most of you don't know me. The only one who knows me very well is Professor Masyad. I've been trained in Great Britain for 15 years. Dr. Masyad saw me in the last 2 months or 3 months. Straight away, I got a job in Canada and I traveled there and I started my career in North America. But what I'm saying this because in the United Kingdom, you don't have the luxury working as a national service to be only a pediatric orthopedic surgeon or spinal surgeon or an arthroplastic surgeon. You have to do everything. Professor Masyad will remember, we have orifice scapulum, then total knee replacement, then congenital dislocation of the head. So in the UK, we are a general orthopedic surgeon and we cannot have the luxury of doing only one thing. The spine, of course, is one of the main tasks we do in the NHS. And I was privileged to work with O'Sullivan and Kerwin, the two guys in the Royal National Orthopedic Hospital who designed this small detail in the technique of lateral recess decompression. I know it is a small detail, but in my opinion, it's a very significant and useful for you working in the lumbar spine, particularly facing the lateral recess syndrome. Okay. Lateral recess syndrome is a very common entity. You see it either during the operation, if you are not well prepared preoperatively and having enough imaging. We used to have these surprises in the late 80s, before the 90s. You know that MRI came in the 1990. I was just arrived in Canada at that time. And before that, really, the CT would not give you the whole picture of the pathoanatomy of the spine you are working on. So the luxury of having exactly what you are working on came after the 1990 with the introduction of the MRI. So you can face it during the operation, before the MRI, but now we can be very precise in our diagnosis and know exactly what we are dealing with well before. So this entity we see in our clinics quite often after the age of 50, as a patient will give you a long history of back pain, which is recently starting to hurt his leg in a very characteristic way, and so on. Failing to decompress the lateral recess syndrome, in my experience, is one of the common reasons of failed back syndrome. I have 68 patients I have accumulated in over 12 or 15 years. I tried this technique of undercutting prostatectomy, pioneered by Dr. Getty and O'Sullivan and Kerwin in the Royal National Orthopedic Hospital. And I must admit that I was very satisfied because almost 88% of the patient has a very high satisfaction rate with this technique. But before we go into this detail, allow me to give you some, or remind you of some of the basic of the lateral recess. Lateral recess is a part of the central canal, just next to the central canal, between the dural sac and the pedicles. So it's a part of the central canal. It is funnel in shape, very narrow cranially, and expand as it goes distally until it becomes very wide in the intervertebral frame. It connects the intra and the extraspinal spaces. Surgical neuroanatomy, the nerve root, I think this is very important also to appreciate that nerve root arise at one motion segment and keep going down the lateral recess to exit, touching the lower motion segment. This is very important, actually, surgical anatomy point in this respect, because you can have one nerve root affected by two pathology at two levels. And if you decompress the nerve root at one level and you forget the other one, the patient will remain symptomatic. So it descends the lateral recess medially and then exit after that. It's of course, I'll explain to you later on that it has three zones, and you have to appreciate this also to be able to decompress everything. Nerve root anomalies in this operation is very important to bear in mind and refresh your memory about it before every operation. Keep it in mind, because failing to decompress both nerve root will leave your patient also with symptoms. And this is a sum of the conjointed nerve root anomalies, which I like to look at from now and then. So I do my best to decompress both nerve root if possible. And this is a part of the schematic presentation of the lateral recess compression. And again, this is the central, and the lateral part of the central canal. Now, this is the lateral process, has three zones. It's not a small detail. I think it's a very important detail to appreciate this neuro anatomy in your mind. It has a entrance zone, mid zone, and exit zone. The entrance zone at the upper motion segment, bordered by the facet joint posteriorly and the disc and the endoplate and part of the body anteriorly. And this is the longest part and the commonest site for compression. Now, it goes down, the nerve root goes down to the mid zone. This is pretty long one and is bordered again by the pars interarticularis anteriorly and posteriorly by the dorsum of the body. And then comes the widest part of the lateral recess, which near the intervertebral foramen. And this again can be a site of compression of the nerve root. So nerve root can be compressed at the three zones, and you have to decompress the nerve root all along to have a good successful result. So it is not a small detail. I think it's a very important detail to keep in mind when you are working in this syndrome. Compression at the mid zone can occur by parts of the articularis osteophyte or the bursal tissue and the fibrocartilaginous tissue you see at the spondylitic defect you see in spondylolysis. Now, this is some diagram also just to remind us about the long course of nerve root from the origin to the exit. Now, the morphology of the lateral recess has two main morphology: the congenital trefoid one, the one on the left-hand side of the screen, and this is a progress, how it progresses from young age to middle age to advanced age, and you can see the nerve root is pretty compressed in the lower one. And then the next one is the acquired trefoil. It's not trefoil at the beginning, but by compression it becomes acquired. And the last one is the angular pinch like compression. And this is almost always acquired one secondary to osteophytic compression from the facet joint or partial tibialis interarticularis osteophyte compression. So, two morphology we have to keep in mind: the congenital trefoil, acquired trefoil, and acute angular pinch like one. And you can see here the four zones of stenosis. Just to remind ourselves, there is also an extra foraminal compression that happens, particularly in the far out syndrome. And when you have spondylolisthesis, you see all of this one. And you have to keep in mind also while you're working this syndrome that you may face such eventuality. Now, again, the neuroanatomy, and you can have your picture. The patient comes to you with a long history of back pain, which recently has been radiated down the leg. It is related to activity, but it can actually keep him up at night, and it has an element of paresthesia or numbness. Almost always has this one. Claudication, actually, in my series only accounted for 17%. That was surprising to me. I thought that this figure would be much higher, being, you know, a compressed narrow compartment. Failing test, we all know, but just to remind you, you keep the patient extended for 1 minute, and that will lead to reproduction of the pain, and once you ask him to bend forward, the pain will go. And this is actually, I find, a very useful, quick screen test in the clinic to diagnose this lateral recess syndrome. Straight leg raising is not very much affected, maybe affected around 30% of the range. Spine range of motion is almost always limited in this patient, because don't forget that he has a very long history of back pain, and most of them they have also disc degeneration. They have also a motor and sensory deficit in the vast majority of cases. CT and MRI, of course, are the best two investigations we have right now. As I told you before, 1990, we had one as a CT, which, okay, we're good for the lateral recess, but will not give you the state of the disc very well, and will not show you other possible extra foraminal or other disc impingement as good as MRI. So having combined CT and MRI are really a superb tool in your hand to go to this operation, and you know exactly what you are going to do. And as I'm going to say, time allowing in the lecture of the athletes need what I call pinpoint operation. Pinpoint operation. You know exactly what to do and do it and come out. Nothing else. Pinpoint surgery. So CT and MRI have really made our life very easy. I know exactly what I'm going to do the night before the operation, and I sleep very comfortably that I'm not going to miss any surprising pathology. Okay. Now we measure it on the cut of the superior pedicle, the distance between the dorsum of the body and the facet joint anteriorly. In my series, the average was 2.7 millimeter, but the range was 2.1 to 3.6 millimeter. MRI, almost all my patients did have disc degeneration disease, or DDD, 95%. Disc herniation occurred only in 30%, and this is a group of patients which required decompression of xanthar recess plus a disc excision. Now, this is one example of the lateral recess syndrome. Very common occurrence, and very common, I'm sure, everybody clinic you see every day. And again, here another one, a disc herniation plus facet joint compression. And again, this is a disc herniation with encroachment on the foramen, not the foramen exactly, but this is just the facet, the mid zone of the facet area. You can actually know exactly even what is the level of the disc herniation I'm going to remove. Exactly, precisely, where it is. What an easy life was an MRI. Now, this is a very good example of the pinch-like type, morphological type of the lateral recess syndrome, having these big osteophytes and very narrowing, particularly on the right side of the lateral recess. And this kind of patients actually are very rewarding cases, because if you go in and again do a pinpoint surgery, I wouldn't, maybe because I'm not a spinal surgeon by training, I will go and do exactly what the patient is complaining of. This patient complained of an L4-5 disc level disease, claudications, compression, CT and MRI show me that this is a situation. I will go and do the undercutting fasciectomy, and the patient actually are very happy after the operation. And I repeat, the patient would not believe himself after surgery. You see him the following day, different doctor, I'm feeling my leg much, much better than before. So actually, this is one of the most rewarding procedures in my hand, in my experience, in my spine work. Very rewarding indeed. Again, another example of this. So indication of surgery here is indication of surgery everywhere. When you have failed in treating this patient conservatively, and you try conservative treatment for approximately 6 months, or if the patient has unrelenting symptoms, compromising his activity, and this is what we call significant morbidity, or there is progressive neurological deficit. This progressive neurological deficit actually we don't see very often in this particular case. But the main two indications are unrelenting pain, which sometimes keep him up at night, and interfering with his function. He cannot walk a good distance at all. And again, precise anatomic pathology. And this thing I missed before the introduction of the MRI. Now with the MRI, I know that the pathology is so-and-so, and I go and do it. Precise anatomic pathology is a prerequisite for such treatment. But it's very important to explain to your patient before surgery that this is not for back pain. You will have your back pain because you have this deterioration in your spine. But I'm treating the new symptom which you develop, which is radicular pain or the leg pain. Very important to make this understood, otherwise he may think that after doing this operation for him, he will become a new man. He will become a man again. This is not true, and you have to be very clear about it, that you still have some back pain. And if the back pain is improved, this is a bonus. And actually, some of them, they have some improvement of back pain, as you're going to see. Now, the advantage of the partial undercutting mastectomy, in my experience and in the Royal National Faith Hospital experience, that the nerve root injury risk is much reduced. And you will tell me that most of you use this carousel, nice carousel, ankle carousel, 2 millimeter or 3 millimeters, and you are very happy about it. That's fair enough, that's good enough. I use this for many, many years, but I always felt that the patient has some degree of nerve root damage to some degree, either paresthesia, tingling, or some sense of loss. The majority of them are really not right. But since I use this technique to undercut the mastectomy, I have no such complaint whatsoever. East of my hand and his experience of the Royal National Orthopedic Hospital. The amount of, and again it preserved the spinal canal depth. It did not affect the depth of the spinal canal. The amount of metaphysectomy would vary 3%. This is a first step we always do, which is a laminotomy fenestration in this region shown diagram. And the next one is the temple of the middle part of the parcel, of the latter part of the, that's, yes, the middle part of the parcel in the internet, parcel internet articularis, just to clear and show you part of the nerve. If you don't see the nerve at this stage, you may have to remove some of the upper facet, upper lamina, to reach more of the facet. Can I continue? Can I give you more? 3-4 minutes more, please?
Yes, yes.
Can you remove this square, please? Sir?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Should you remove my father? Now the technique will come. I use 10 millimeter stereospitom. Stereospitom is the one I use. It's a Swedish one. It's a very nice one, very firm, very durable. And angles of blade will be almost parallel to the nerve root, or roughly parallel to the spinal canal, tilted slightly outwards. Okay. Always keep a McDonald's dissector between the facet joint and the nerve root, just in case you have leg breakfast and you make an impact and you enter it and you are protected. And then a rapid, gentle bangs by the osteotome. Not 1, 2, 3, no. Rapid, gentle bangs by the osteotome, and then a gentle one. And then you feel by your proprioception that you almost remove 90% of the width of the inferior facet. And then you twist the osteotome, the inferior facet portion will go. Okay? And then it will come to the superior facets, the important one, the culprit one, the one which is causing compression, and you do the same thing, also apply the osteotome almost virtually parallel to the nerve root, and again, gentle bangs, 90%, and then twist the osteotome, and the piece will come out, and keep your McDonald's retractor or the sector between the facet one and the nerve root. Having done that is not usually, this is the end result, and you can see that the process is pretty clear now, and don't forget, the thing which I mentioned earlier on, that you have to clear the nerve root from the origin, from the entrance zone to the mid zone to the exit of the IVF to be sure of the result. And you may have to go back to some of the upper lamina to do this. And again, if you cannot squeeze the nerve root, it means that there is hypertrophy of the facet joint encroaching medially on the nerve root and hiding it completely. And this again means that you have to do a little bit more hard work. Again, the conjoint intent, which I faced only one case out of 66 cases in this one. Now, I have 64 patients, 54 male and 30 male, in age range between 31 and 72. 22 had previous surgery, escaped me in the vast majority of cases. Symptoms spanned an average 9 years, and all received conservative management for at least 6 months. Preoperative symptoms, back and leg pain was a dominant 85%. Leg pain only was 11% claudication, as I said, was surprisingly low at 17%, leg weakness 18%, and paresthesia about 55% of the cases. Preoperative signs, vision motion diminished, but at least 30% in one or more direction. This was the vast majority of the patient, 31%. Motor deficit 48%, sensory deficit 40%, absent reflexion 44%, SLR diminished by 30% in more than 29 degrees. Follow up. X-ray was done in flexion and extension. Follow-up expanded between 1 and 6 years, average 3 years, and I always have follow-up for flexion extension view after 3 months from the surgery. Decompression was unilateral 88%, bilateral 12%. One nerve root only was decompressed in two-thirds of the cases, and two or more in the last third. L5, S1 nerve root were the dominating ones to be decompressed. Only one case, L4, was done. It's taken down in 30% of cases, and one case only had conjointed L5, S1, and and that was clear and decompressed completely in the operation. Now, the results, good result, being complete relief of the pain and returned almost to normal activity, and that was in 58%, fair degree in 30%, and poor one, no relief at all in 12%. 4 out of these 12 of 10 patients with a poor result were actually had psychosomatic disease before the operation. And I knew this before the operation, and I know that some of you will not operate in such patients, but my personal experience actually indicated this, because the biggest test in my life I removed was in Newfoundland, in Canada, and it was in a schizophrenic patient. He's about 1.5 times my size, and you know, the guy who handed me over this clinic, you know, before he left, he told me this guy has been sitting here I did not have at that time MRI. I relied on CT scan, which really is not as even half as good as MRI, and they were not sure that he had a disc arrest. I decided at that time that I should operate this man, and I was correct in my sensation because this patient had the biggest disc in my life. So I will not prevent the patient with psychosomatic illnesses from having surgery at all. In conclusion, result okay. No reflex action was recovered at all, but almost two-thirds of the motor deficit was recovered. And this is the one which you always do. I'm sure most of you use this kerosene one. I do respect this. If it is good in your hand, please carry on. But in my hand, I always had some problem with that. In conclusion, undercutting partial vasectomy is a safe technique, easy technique, and patient satisfaction will reach almost 88%. Thank you very much.